Next week, we finish the book of Ezra. Does anyone remember what the book of Ezra is about? It's about spiritual renewal, spiritual renewal. And if you've been tracking along with this, we looked at chapter one was first you hear from God. Second, you come back into fellowship. Third is you reestablish worship. Fourth is you face opposition. Fifth is you just keep going. Chapter 6 is you see God move. It took 2 decades before they saw God move in this miraculous way. Then after seeing God move, the word of God was what in chapter 7? It was restored. Chapter 8, the men came back last week and were leading as humble leaders. And in chapter 9 this week, we're going to see that they face temptation. And so if you have walked through these steps, and what it implies is that there's a time where you were really close with God, everyone who comes to faith in Christ, remember back, if you'll think back to when you first got saved, and you were super excited, weren't you? For the first time, you understood who God was. You understood that forgiveness came, not as some works-based righteousness that you did enough things to earn God's love or favor, but for the first time, you came to genuine faith and realized that salvation comes by faith alone, through Christ alone. And you were excited, and you were like, man, my chains are gone. You were free. You loved God. You started reading the word, and it was so exciting, right? But if we're not careful, what happens? We start to slide away from those truths. And they'll start, and our hearts start to kind of get hard again. And in our minds, those truths start to just kind of disappear again. And we start to be inundated by worldly thoughts again. And that's really a picture of what Ezra was dealing with. These people at one time were worshiping. The temple was fabulous. They were worshiping God there. God was meeting with his people. But they drifted away from God. And over a long period of time, that disobedience led to their removal from the land, where they end up in Babylonian captivity. Then when the Persians, the Medo-Persians, which the Medes got kicked out, the Persians ultimately ruled, the Persians send the people back, don't they? 70 years later, you have the first return, chapters 1 through 6, and under Zerubbabel, but then you have a 50-year gap. The second return under Ezra, the third return is under Nehemiah. We look at Nehemiah as the next book in the Bible. Nehemiah and Ezra were one book until 4th century A.D. And so this whole series of events is really just God telling us how he functioned in regards to his people so that we would learn how to function today in appropriate ways. So all scripture is inspired by God and profitable, right? Whether you're talking Old Testament, New Testament, New Testament's easier for us to get, right? Because it's a one-for-one. We're New Covenant people. We're in the New Covenant now, and so it's easy for us to understand. The Old Testament, not as clear, because a lot of times it's not one-for-one, so we don't look at the sacrifices, and sometimes we look at what's going on, wars, sacrifices, and go, how does that relate? And yet it's all profitable. So our goal is to understand not only in the New Testament what God wants from our lives, but also from the Old Testament. So let's say that you have gone through these steps, whatever the chaos, the confusion, the darkness, the feeling of being distant from God, all of that leads to worry, it leads to quickly getting angry, it leads to all kinds of emotional and mental duress. But let's say you walk through these things, you're back going, man, I'm close with God, I'm at peace again. You're really set on glorifying God and doing good works. It's what we do, right? When we're focused on God, when we're glorifying God, we are doing, then we set out to do good works and be a blessing to people. That's what happens. And so let's say you're back in that and you're going, man, these people had come back into the land. They're back in that sense where God designed them to be. What do we have to be careful of? Temptation, right? Have you ever thought, you come out of a dark season, you come out of a difficult season, and I'm not talking about just darkness and difficulty from the standpoint that we live in a fallen world. We all face a lot of difficulty. I'm talking about difficulty that's self-inflicted, right? We've all been there too, right? We come out of difficulty that's self-inflicted. We're back with God. Our temptation is to think, what? I will never go back to that. But what we need to do is we need to take heed in those times lest we fall. Because once these people come back into land, God's people come back into land, they're restored, the temple is reestablished, the worship is going on, you would think, man, it's clear sailing, everything's going to go well, I'm going to stay in this position of closeness with God and intimacy with God, and I'm never going back to that prison cell again. But we have to be so careful. Here's what 1 Corinthians 10 says. Nevertheless, in verse 5 of 1 Corinthians 10. Nevertheless, with most of them, God was not well pleased. And he's talking about those who came out with Moses, and these were the people who left Egypt with Moses. Nevertheless, with most of them, God was not well pleased, for they were laid low in the wilderness. He's talking about all of that generation died in the wilderness. Now, these things happened as examples for us. So these Old Testament were examples for us New Testament believers, so that we would not crave evil things as they also craved. Do not be idolaters, as some of them were, as it was written, the people sat down to eat and drink and stood up to play. Nor let us act immorally, as some of them did, and 23,000 fell in one day. Now, this is the New Testament, so we think all the tough stuff's in the Old Testament. There's a lot of tough stuff throughout the Bible, right? Nor let us try the Lord, as some of them did, and were destroyed by serpents. Verse 10 of 1 Corinthians 10 says, nor grumble, as some of them did, and they were destroyed by the destroyer. Now these things happened to them as an example. He continually reminds us of that. And they were written for our instruction, upon whom the ends of the ages have come. Therefore, let him who thinks he stands take heed, lest he as he does not fall. What is the temptation when we're back to walking with God appropriately? The temptation is that we immediately fall again, right? When you're walking, when you're in a time of a good season spiritually, you're probably going to face a lot of temptation that's going to be thrown at you to get you back over in a dark season where you're dishonoring God, where you're no longer glorifying God or doing good works. No temptation has overtaken you. Isn't that don't we think that in temptation? Man, nobody else is facing this. But he says, but such as is common to man. Every temptation you faced and I faced, they're common. So we need to not convince ourselves that, man, nobody else is feeling this. That's not true. The temptations we all face are common, and Jesus felt these temptations as well. Not the exact same specific things, but all that he faced encompasses all that we'll ever face. He did so without sin, Hebrews says. And he will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you're able, but with the temptation will also provide the way of escape so you'll be able to endure it. So we have an out to every temptation. We have the knowledge that God will never allow the temptation to become more than we're able to bear. It becomes very important. Because once you're back with God, you need to be careful. Not think, oh, I'll never go back there again, but think, wow. If I'm going to stay close with God, I got to recognize these temptations. And so we're in Ezra and chapter 9, if you want to turn there with me, in Ezra chapter 9 this morning. Because what we find in chapter 9 is really what we find throughout all the historical books of the Bible, the Old Testament. It's a testimony of why God's people faced so much difficulty and ultimately were exiled from the land. So if you remember back in chapter 4 of Ezra, we covered two individuals from the Persian government, Rehum and Shimshai, sent a letter to Artaxerxes, and they warned him, and they said in this letter, these two officials in chapter 4 said, if you let them rebuild Jerusalem, those people will rebel against you. And what they said is, the history of that place, the history of Jerusalem, is that they always rebel against every king that gets put over them. Was that true? That's true. But the interesting thing is these two Persian officials didn't know the half of it. The irony of it is that was their great demise, but it was more than that they rebelled against the various authorities over them. It was their demise came because they continually rebelled against the one authority over all mankind. And actually, the elders of it pick up in chapter 5 when the Jewish leaders give this testimony in chapter 5, verse 12. Because our fathers angered the God of heaven, he handed them over to Nebuchadnezzar, the Chaldean king of Babylon, who destroyed this temple and deported the people of Babylon. Wow. Why did they have so much difficulty in their life? It was because they had rejected one king who sits above all kings. One king whose kingdom is above all kingdoms. One king who was commanding them to come with him that he might bless them, and they continually rejected him. It's really the testimony that's consistent with Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Kings, Chronicles. You just read through any of them and you find this consistent testimony. Are God's people generally very obedient or generally very disobedient? They're generally very disobedient. Does it go well for them or poorly for them as a result? Generally, it goes very poorly, right? And yet, We have a fairly long track record, wouldn't you agree, by this point in human history, of how it goes poorly when we don't go God's way and how it goes well when we go God's way. We'd agree that a few thousand years gives us a pretty fair example, right? But do we struggle in the same ways? Man, we do, right? We do. And that's why 1 Corinthians 10, verse 5 through 13 becomes so important, because this was written for our example so that we don't fall for those same temptations. Has Satan been alive and well since the beginning of creation? Yeah. Has he had to change his schemes and tactics too much? He hasn't changed them too much, right? He's pretty good at this, knowing how to play on our flesh, and yet it's really not, well, the devil made me do it. That's not a biblical concept, because James 1 says, no temptation has overcome you, but such, actually that's 1 Corinthians 10, but James 1 says the temptations we face are really not from God, but they are solicitations of our own flesh. And so when we give in, that temptation becomes sin and leads to death. It's our own responsibility to resist. And James 4 says, resist the devil, he'll flee from you. And so the question then becomes, when you look at the difficulty they face, and this becomes important as we look at temptation, why? What was so bad about what they did that lent itself to so much chaos and so much difficulty? Well, really, to understand the Old Testament, you got to understand what? Does anyone know? It goes back to the law. So when you read the Old Testament, you got to read it through the eyes of the law. The law being that God had commanded and directed his people to do certain things and to avoid other things. And in the Old Testament, it was much more narrow between the do's and don'ts than it is in the New Testament, right? So we have a broader span because we have a permanent indwelling of the Holy Spirit. But if you look back at, you don't even have to turn here, but in Leviticus, he says this, and this kind of sets it up as to why they face so much difficulty. In 26 of Leviticus, he says, if you walk in my statutes and keep my commandments so as to carry them out, so what's he saying? You got to do what? You got to obey, right? Then I shall give you rains in their season so that the land will yield its produce and the trees of the field will bear their fruit. Does God seem to think that he controls the rain? Yeah. Verse 5, indeed, your threshing will last for you until grape gathering, and grape gathering will last until sowing time. You will thus eat your food to the full and live securely in your land. He says, man, your harvests are going to be great. You're going to be just finishing reaping, and it'll already be planting season again. I'm just going to bless you, right? I shall also grant peace in the land. Is that the history of Israel? Just a peaceful place, right? That place is crazy. People are like, hey, we're going on a trip to, I was in a seminary there. I was like, we're going on a trip to Israel. Hey, good. If I had money to fly somewhere, it wouldn't be there. I think Hawaii. You know, there's a bunch of nut jobs over there, right? But it's so much a historical place. One day I'm going to check it out, but I'm going to wait till Jesus is ruling and reigning, right? Actually, it could be cool to go before then, but just, it's been a crazy place, right? And I shall also grant peace in the land so that you may lie down with no one making you tremble. That's the exact opposite of almost the entire history of that place, right? I shall also eliminate harmful beasts from the land, and no sword will pass through the land, but you will chase your enemies, and they will fall before you by the sword. 5 of you will chase 100, and 100 of you will chase 10,000, and your enemies will fall before you by the sword. Does that sound like the history of Israel? There were certain glimpses of that when Gideon, and you've got certain times where the people were super obedient, and they really started to, whether it was Joshua and Caleb or whether it was some of the various times, but overwhelmingly, it's not the history of it. Because listen to this, the penalties of disobedience really comes in verse 14, and he says, but if you do not obey me and you do not carry out all these commandments, if instead you reject my statutes and if your soul abhors my ordinances so as not to carry out all my commandments and so break my covenant, I in turn will do this to you. I will point over you a sudden terror, consumption and fever that will waste away and eyes that cause the soul to pine away. And you will sow your seed uselessly, for your enemy will eat it up. I will set my face against you so that you will be struck down before your enemies, and those who hate you will rule over you. Does that sound more like the history of Israel? Being ruled over by others? Does that seem like a very productive land? Like, man, you just grow everything there, right? It's a pretty unproductive place. Those who hate you will rule over you, and you will flee when no one is pursuing you. If also after these things you do not obey me, then I will punish you seven times more for your sins. And if you skip down to verse 23 of Leviticus 26, it says, and if by these things you are not turned to me, but act with hostility against me, then I will act with hostility against you, and I, even I, will strike you seven times for your sins. And so what he's saying is, you can choose to come and obey me. You can believe that I'm telling you the truth and obey me. And he says, I've got all this wonderful stuff for you. But in Leviticus 26, he says, but the opposite is true too. He says, if you choose to reject me, you go against me, you make me your enemy, you disregard my thoughts, you go against me, he lists a lot more stuff that he's going to do. And he says, if this doesn't happen, if even if I've blown up your life, you still reject me, I'm going to come at it again, right? So on one hand, we say, well, praise God, we're not in the Old Testament. On the other hand, we need to learn from these things, right? Because what was written in former times, 1 Corinthians 10 says, was written for our benefits. Does God still enjoy when we obey him? He still enjoys when we obey him. Is there still difficulty and suffering and, needlessly so, these distresses that come upon us when we reject him? It is true, right? It's not the same. It's not a one for one. It's not like, well, you can tell by how obedient you've been by looking at your garden. Thankfully, that's not true because our garden stinks. And if that were the case, we would be in trouble with the Lord here. But it's not a one for one. But the principle is still there. So back in Ezra, this whole thing, they're come back in the land, but this is what he says in verse 7, and then we're going to backtrack. Since the days of our fathers to this day, this is Ezra 9:7, we have been in great guilt, and on account of our iniquities, we, our kings and our priests, have been given into the hand of the kings of the lands, to the sword, to captivity, and to plunder, and to open shame, as it is to this day. Who is Ezra saying? Why is Ezra saying all this difficulty has come upon him? What's that? Yeah, because there's been a continual disregard for God's word, right? And so really in this chapter on temptation, he's rehearsing, he's looking back and saying, man, we've been in this position, we're just coming back into the land, and look at this, chapter 9, verse 1. Now when these things had been completed, the princes approached me, saying, the peoples of Israel and the priests of the Levites have not separated themselves from the peoples of the lands, according to their abominations. So when the people get back to the land after this long journey, they've given up everything, they've come back to worship God, but what do they quickly do? They become just like what? They become worldly. This is crazy. Of those of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Jebusites, the Amorites, the Moabites, the Egyptians, and the Ammonites. For they have taken some of their daughters as wives for themselves and for their sons, so that the holy race has intermingled with the peoples of the lands. Indeed, the hands of the princes and the rulers have been foremost in this unfaithfulness. Listen to this. Tell me what you think about this guy, if this were somebody here. When I heard about this matter, I tore my garment and my robe and pulled some of the hair from my head and my beard, and I sat down appalled. You get that? Then everyone who trembled at the word of the of God of Israel, so everyone who feared God's word like he did, on account of the unfaithfulness of the exiles, gathered to me, and I sat appalled until the evening offering. But at the evening offering, I rose from my humiliation, even with my garment and my robe torn, and I fell on my knees and stretched out my hands to the Lord my God. And I said, oh my God, I am ashamed and embarrassed to lift up my face to you. My God, for our iniquities have risen above our heads, and our guilt has gone even over to the heavens. Since the days of our fathers to this very day, we have been guilty of great guilt, and on account of our iniquities, we, our kings, and our priests have been given into the hand of the kings of the lands, to the sword, to captivity, to plunder, and open shame, as is this day. But now, for a brief moment, grace has been shown from the Lord our God to leave us an escaped remnant and to give us a peg in his holy place, that our God may enlighten our eyes and grant us a little reviving in our bondage. For we are slaves, yet in our bondage, our God has not forsaken us. Did God forsake them? He never forsook them, but has extended loving kindness to us in the sight of the kings of Persia to give us a reviving, to raise us up the house of our God, to restore its ruins, and to give us a wall in Judah and Jerusalem. Now, our God, what shall we say after this? For we have forsaken your commandments, which you have commanded by your servant the prophet, saying, the land which you are entering to possess is an unclean land, with uncleanliness of the peoples of the land, with their abominations, which they have filled it to the, from one end to the other, and with their iniquities. And so you look at this. What's going on? They've finally gone through this whole process of spiritual renewal, only to what? They went through everything. They gave up everything in their homes they lived in for 70 years. They'd gone through this long journey, all this danger. They prayed, and God provided all these things to get back in the land, and they immediately do what? They immediately start looking around and go, man, these ladies are cute. I think I'm going to marry that girl. Oh, hey, son, have you noticed that girl? And they just immediately what? They immediately start taking on the flavor, the pagan flavor of the world around them. This was, by the way, a very common thing. Back when Balak pays Balaam to curse God's people and he pronounces a curse, but every time, what happens? The words that come out of his mouth are a blessing, not a curse. Finally, he goes back to Balak. He says, and Balak is steamed. He's the king. He says, man, I paid you to curse those people because you're supposed to be this prophet, right? You were supposed to speak prophetically and that curse was going to work. He says, hey, man. Don't kill me on this thing. I cannot do it if God isn't allowed. And he has not allowed them to be cursed. He has determined to bless them. But, king, I've got a plan for you. You send some ladies over there, these guys will fall from. They'll intermingle, they'll become worldly, and they'll be done. And he did just that. What? So the fact is, God's people again and again fall for these same ridiculous things, right? And so the very sin that they break, verse 12, the main thing is continuing to intermarry. He says, verse 12, so now do not give your daughters to their sons, nor take their daughters to your sons, and never seek their peace or their prosperity, that you may be strong and eat the good things of the land and leave it as an inheritance to your sons forever. So what command did they break? They continually broke the command not to intermingle, not to intermarry. What was wrong with intermarriage that he's talking about? They weren't equally yoked. So the main problem with what they were doing was they were marrying people who didn't worship God, right? That was the whole the whole crux of the issue was they were going and marrying people who didn't worship God, and as a result, they ended up walking away from God. Their kids ended up walking away from God. Does God still desire that for his people, if they're to marry, are they still to marry only somebody also who worships God? Yeah, it's not a race thing at all, is it? It's not a race thing, an age thing, or anything. It's a, do they worship God? That's what we're to be about, right? It's what they were to be about, we're to be about. When you marry, you're to marry someone who worships God. That's the important issue, and that becomes maybe more challenging in a day where 70-something percent of America claims to be Christian, and you say, well, it has to be more than that, because there's a lot of people who claim to be Christian who aren't necessarily Christians, but it's an important principle, isn't it? You, as a worshiper of God, when it comes time to marry, you need to marry someone who's a worshiper of God, and they didn't do that, and ultimately, they became very enamored with the things going on, the worldliness around them. After all this has come upon us, verse 13, and for our evil deeds and for our great guilt, since you, our God, have requited us less than our iniquities deserve and have given us an escape remnant as this, shall we again break your commandments and intermarry with the peoples who commit these abominations? Now, this is a super huge, insightful thought from Ezra. He has just come back to the land. They've been in exile for 120 years. And what does he say? And in exile, they almost get annihilated. Remember, that's the book of Esther. He gets back and he says, you have certainly punished us what? Less than our sin deserves. Do you think there were people there that were like, man, God is too heavy-handed? I can almost guarantee you a large portion of those people thought, what is so bad about what we've done? Come on. And especially the world around them. Do you think the world around them had any problems with them intermarrying? Worshiping their gods, doing what they did. Nobody around us today, Matt, would care a bit, would they? They would think we are lunatics for even being that committed to worshiping God and even thinking in terms of, hey, I would have to find someone else who worships God as well, right? So after all that, Ezra says, man, he has certainly punished less than we deserve. Is that a good response to God's punishment? It is, isn't it? You see, Ezra had the heart for God. When we look at Ezra's heart, when the people, they were just acting like the world, how did Ezra take that? When he gets back to land, he finds that all the people, even the returned remnant, is being like the world around them. What does he do? He pulls out his beard, yanks out some of his hair. What would you do if Ivan, on Facebook tomorrow, posts something where he's ripped out part of his hair, ripped out that cool goatee or part of it, he's tore his clothes, and he's sitting there on Facebook, and he's praying on his knees? What would you think of him? You'd probably be like, note to self, don't invite him over for game night this Friday, right? Yeah. You'd be like, that's weird. Do you think the people thought it weird of Ezra then? They probably did. And I'm not suggesting we should go about yanking our beards out or our hair out, but I think that what you see in Ezra's life, does he have a similar heart as God when it comes to understanding the sinfulness of sin? Yeah. Do we struggle to really understand the sinfulness of sin? As evangelicals, there's a big movement in evangelical circles to say that hell is not real. Hell is not real. And a lot of evangelical pastors have bought into that because they can't even begin to fathom how God could ever do that. It is tough, isn't it? There are some tough realities. But the reality is this. The bigger question, and this is the one the angels seem to ask, is how could God ever let sinful people into heaven? And so that's what the angels long to look into is, how could God forgive sinners? They recognize the gospel, they recognize the cross, and yet it's still something that fascinates them, right? So as fallen human beings who oftentimes treat sin as though it's really not that serious, Ezra looks at it very much like God does. This is so serious. So in your own minds, do you know what God's commanded you? Because we're in the New Testament, right? But does God give any commands in the New Testament? He does give commands in the New Testament, right? Does he expect us, by the way, to obey those commands? He does expect that. Should we be concerned if we don't obey those commands? It should concern us, right? God had to blow up their lives. And remember in Leviticus 26, he says, and if you don't get it, I'm going to pile it on seven times more. And if you don't get it, I'm going to pile it on seven times more. Do you think some of God's own people today will have to have God blow up their life before they really get it? I think so. Do you think God will blow up some people's life and they still don't get it? Because that's what happened in the Old Testament, right? There's still, even though Ezra's pulling out his hair, he's going, all this came upon us? I mean, he's thrashed our lives, and now we're going to it again? I mean, and he's yanking on his hair, and he's just grieving. He's crying out to God. How could that just be? The majority of them still were like, God had blown up their life, and they're still going back to it again, right? So sometimes God will blow up marriages. He'll blow up. Some people will have to lose their kids, lose their finances, and lose their health, you name it, before they ever get it, right? And some still won't. Isn't that a shame? But it should grieve us that God has to act in such severe measure to get our attention when he's done everything at the cross, and all we have to do is by faith say, I'm just going to trust that he's telling me the truth, and I'm going to go his way and obey. Right? That's all he's saying. And yet his way is so contrary to what the world's saying, and we get so inundated by the world's thoughts that sometimes what he's saying is like, I don't know. Can I trust him? Because all my friends are saying, because what people on Facebook would think of me if they actually could see, you know what I mean? A lot of times we think in world's wisdom rather than in God's wisdom. Well, he goes on, he says, shall we again break your commandments and intermarry with the peoples who commit these abominations? Would you not be angry with us to the point of destruction until there is no remnant nor any who escape? Now, at this point, Ezra is going, this could end up in complete annihilation for your people. Why would that not be the case? Because God had made a covenant, right? God had made a covenant so he would never completely destroy his people, would he? He was always going to bear patiently with them. Even in this, Ezra recognizes all the years that they had faced difficulty, God has still been patient. O Lord God of Israel, last verse in chapter 9, you are righteous, for we have been left an escaped remnant as it is this day. Behold, we are before you in our guilt, for no one can stand before you because of this. Here's the thing. Even if you go through the process of going, man, coming back into a point where you are simply going, man, I love Jesus again. And hopefully if someone were to come to you and say, hey, do you love Jesus more now than you did last year? Hopefully you could say, yes, I love Jesus more now than I did last year. Do you love Jesus more now than you did 5 years ago? Hopefully you'd say, man, I love Jesus so much more now than I did 5 years ago. But that's not always the case, is it? Because we can get into dark seasons. When you get into dark seasons, when you've gotten distant from God, you've listened to other temptations, you've gone that way, life starts to get dark and hard, doesn't it? You start to be very much under duress. The joy is gone, the peace is gone. All of a sudden, you are quick to anger. You ever met somebody, even a Christian, who's quick to get angry? It happens, doesn't it? Was Christ quick to get angry? No, he wasn't quick to get angry. You met Christians, even born-again believers, who are under such duress. We've all been there, haven't we? That we don't even have peace. It's just life is dark and hard and difficult. We don't have to live in that. Do you know that Christ, not only do we not follow the sins of the people around us and should we not fall into their worldliness, when we do fall in sin, we know how to get out of it. The world says, well, here, come on, I'll go to your shrink and he'll have a 5-year plan for you and all this stuff. And we go, no, you don't understand. I'm a redeemed child of God. For me to get out of stuff is repentance and getting back into right relationship with God. My God spoke the world into existence, and I talk to him, and he hears me. I don't need all of your this and that. I got into this mess because I went with the world's wisdom. I can't get out of it through the world's wisdom. I know God, and I know his promises. To me, getting out of this mess is getting back through repentance, coming back to listening to God, back to fellowship, back to worship, going long through difficulty, that whole process. But then I've got to be on guard, and you need to be on guard. And Hebrews says, encourage one another day after day, as long as it's still called today, so that none of you will be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. What is deceitfulness? Deception, right? Does sin ever trick you into believing that it's going to turn out good this time? Even though you did it 100 times back there and it never turned out good, right? So sin is like playing Russian roulette, except you know what happens when you spin the wheel? Every chamber is loaded. Every chamber. Russian roulette, where they put one bullet in there, Satan says, here, I've got all chambers loaded. Here, spin the wheel and see how it goes for you. Sin is always suicidal for your joy and peace. It will never result in good. And soon as Satan has you and you fall for that sin, what's the next thing he does? You couldn't possibly be a Christian. And he just heaps judgment on you. And if you keep going in that, well, I better find some kind of worldly wisdom to fix my worldliness. Worldly wisdom will never fix worldliness. Repentance does. When you come back through repentance into spiritual renewal, where you have peace again, you love Jesus again, you actually are fixated on God's glory again, and you're doing good works again, be careful. Encourage, 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 and find people around you who will encourage, 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 because sin is so deceptive, and it will destroy you. And some are so stuck in it that the only way for God to get their attention is to blow up their life. Don't go that way. And so I think that in the midst of this and what God would have for us 2,500 years later is that we too need to say, wow, just because we're walking with God faithfully, just because we're loving Jesus today does not make any guarantees that we can't fall for sin tomorrow. In fact, you've never seen anyone who has fallen for sin that you're immune from. You could fall into any sin that anyone else does. But for the grace of God, you too and I too would be in these sins. It's just God's grace. So walk humbly. Know that Satan is out to trip you up and temptation is around the corner and you're going to have to stay close with God. Let me finish this by just reading out of James and we'll close this. But in James, which has become such an important part of this, he says this: blessed is the man who perseveres under trials, for once he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life which the Lord has promised to those who love him. Let no one say when he's tempted, I am being tempted by God. God has never tempted any one of us, right? For God cannot be tempted by evil, and he himself does not tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when he is carried away and enticed by his own lust. By whose lust? His own lust. You know, every one of us, because we still have, while we have the Spirit, so we have a greater desire to please God, we still live in the flesh. And the flesh is drawn to sin like a magnet to steel, right? When we are carried away and enticed by our own lust. Then when lust is conceived, it gives birth to sin. And when sin is accomplished, it brings forth what? Death. Has it brought sin? Has the temptation which led to sin, which leads to death, has that been an ongoing process for thousands of years? It has been. Even for God's people? It has been. Is it at work today in your life? Well, every one of us has been tempted this week. So as we close, think about, where are you tempted? Are you needing to still go through the process of spiritual renewal so that you can be at peace? Have joy? Were you really consumed with loving Jesus again and God's glory and doing good works? Or maybe you're still in the need of working through that process. Or if you've worked through that process, or this is a good season, you need to be on guard against those temptations, those solicitations to evil, right? And you need encouragement, and you need to give encouragement, because one or the other is going to be put to death. Either you're going to put to death the flesh and sin, or it's going to put you to death. But it is a mortal battle. And to not recognize the battle is to lose the battle. So let me pray. Father, we just come and we can look back, and there's some strange stuff, Lord. It strikes us as odd when we look at Ezra ripping out his beard and his hair, and yet we can certainly see the heart of a man who seems to be so in tune to how you see this evil. Lord, we have to acknowledge, I need to acknowledge, Lord, I'm a stranger to your holiness. When I read the scriptures, when I look at how holy you are, so holy in fact that the justified punishment for those who've rejected you is hell for eternity, it's hard for me to even fathom your holiness. And yet I know, I look and I read this and I believe it firmly that you're that holy. And I look at Ezra's life and I see how radically committed he was to this holiness, not only in his own life, but in your people's life. And so, God, I pray right now. I know that you hear, that you listen to our prayers, all because of what Jesus did on the cross, that our sin is covered, that it's been removed as far as the east is from the west, that there is therefore now no condemnation for us who are in Christ. And we just praise you for that. And yet we recognize that as a good father in Hebrews 12, that you still discipline us, that you may still bring a lot of difficulty upon us when we wander and walk away in order to return us back to that place where you designed us to be in worship. God, I don't know where each of us are this morning, but I pray that we would all be seeking to be centered on your glory, loving you more than we've loved you in the past, obeying you so as to do good works and be a blessing. God, I pray that whatever those temptations are in each of our lives, that we would have people around us who would be aware of that, can keep encouraging us to stay free from those things, that through your Holy Spirit we'd keep responding, and through your word we'd be renewed day by day, renewing our mind. God, we just seek your forgiveness now, even as we come to take the communion and recognize that you being God, in perfect holiness, you came into this sin-filled world and ultimately were spit on. You were beaten beyond human recognition, stripped naked, and nailed to a cross, rejected of man, and yet you did so to absorb our sin. So I pray that if anyone's trusting in anything but you this morning for their salvation, that today would be the day of salvation. We know you rose from the grave and you overcame sin, death, Satan, and demons, and you've never gone back, and we believe that we are free from all of these things, that one day we'll be in your presence. So help us to live faithfully now. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. There's communion, so just pray, and as you feel led, you can take communion.